We're hearing more and more every day on the press and in the social media and on the telly about the terrible damage we humans are inflicting on our climate from the burning of fossil fuels to power our modern day lifestyles. Most people nowadays get the general idea that those fossil fuels are derived from organic matter that's been compacted down over millions and millions of years to form rich seams of coal, oil and gas, and that the burning of those fossil fuels causes the carbon in them to be rapidly released into our atmosphere in the form of carbon dioxide, methane and other greenhouse gases. That's been the headline, hasn't it? It's kind of like the poster child for global warming and climate change. But there's another aspect of our modern human civilization that up until fairly recently didn't get anything like as much coverage, but that arguably is just as impactful on our rapidly accelerating climate crisis. And that's the way we use and abuse our land and soil. On the 8th of August 2019, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, or IPCC, released this new report called Climate Change and Land, with a subtitle, An IPCC Special Report on Climate Change, Desertification, Land Degradation, Sustainable Land Management, Food Security, and Greenhouse Gas Fluxes in Terrestrial Ecosystems. So what's this all about then? Hello and welcome to Just Have a Think. The IPCC gets a pretty hard time from just about every angle these days. There's lots of people who think that these reports are far too watered down by politicians and international lawyers, and that the message these things deliver is so diluted and unambitious that it drives complacency in the general public. And there are, of course, those on the other side of the climate argument who claim the whole thing is a hoax and that the IPCC are nothing more than political puppets and government shills. Whichever way you look at it, these reports are produced as part of the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, overseen by the United Nations Environment Programme and the World Meteorological Organization. Ultimately though, every single IPCC report has to be signed off by just about every single government on the planet, so it does seem a little bit imprudent to ignore them altogether. So this week we're going to just take a very brief look at the main points raised by the IPCC in this report, and we're going to take a look at some of the counter-commentary that it's provoked as a result. The way we humans use our planet's resources directly affects more than 70% of the ice-free parts of the Earth's land area. And here's how the IPCC report tells us that our land use is broken down. Only 1% of it is covered in infrastructure, that's our roads and towns and cities. About 12% is land that we use to grow crops, a little bit of which is irrigated, but most of which is not. And then there's around 37% to pasture, savannas and shrubland, with a whopping 19% of all available land on Earth used for extensive pasture. The remainder of the 70% that humans use is for plantations and managed forests that are specifically designed to produce timber for construction, furniture and all the other stuff we make out of wood. And that leaves about 30% made up of wild, unforested ecosystems, as well as forests not touched by humans, and quite a bit of barren land and rock. The IPCC tells us that the surface temperature over land has risen more than twice as much as the global average temperature since pre-industrial times. And this change in our climate that's brought the increase in frequency of extreme weather events is now starting to impact on food security and natural ecosystems quite hard, and it's also contributing to desertification and land degradation in many regions around the globe. According to the report, about 23% of all human-induced greenhouse gas emissions come from agriculture, forestry, and other land use. This chart shows very clearly how we've forced crop yields upwards in a relatively short term, not just by massively increasing the amount of land we use for growing food, largely by burning or cutting down forestry land, but also by flooding that land with inorganic nitrogen fertilizer. And it's not just the sheer number of people on the planet today, which by the way is about 7.6 billion compared to 3.6 billion when I was born back in 1969, but we're all troughing far more calories each than we used to. So what we've got going on here is what you might call a bit of a double whammy. Take a look at this chart from the report. Population increased by nearly 150% since 1961. Total calories consumed per person, on average, up by about 40%. The number of people classed as underweight has gone down by nearly 50%, and the number of overweight and obese people has almost doubled. You probably don't need me to point out that these statistics do not bode well for the future prosperity of our species. And then there's a chart on desertification and land degradation. This line shows how inland wetland areas have decreased since 1961, down by about 30%, with all the loss of habitat and crucial ecosystems that go along with them. Dryland areas in drought annually have gone up and down quite erratically, but the long-term trend is firmly upwards by almost 50%. And that's really brought into sharp focus when you overlay the trend line for population in areas experiencing desertification, up by a massive 200% since 1961. The IPCC have used these colourful bar charts in their previous reports to illustrate the growing risks in various areas as our average global temperatures continue to rise. In this report, they focus on the effects that rising temperatures will have specifically on our land. White denotes an undetectable change, yellow is moderate, red is high risk, and purple is very high risk. And this time around, they overlay some little commentary boxes to make sure we really get the message. So for example, if our atmosphere's temperature increases by just another degree or so, there'll be a 50% increase in the area burned in the Mediterranean. Another degree on top of that will bring sustained food supply disruptions all over the planet. The IPCC use what they call shared socioeconomic pathways, or SSPs, to compare various future scenarios. And we looked at these back in October when the IPCC released their SR15 report. Here's a quick resume of what we learned then. There are five SSPs. SSP1 is a sustainable development pathway, which is kind of their best case scenario. SSP2 is called middle of the road development, which is kind of their middle of the road pathway. SSP3 is called regional rivalry, where potential conflicts are factored in. SSP4 deals with inequality, and SSP5 is called fossil fuel development pathway, which as you can imagine is the worst case scenario. And they've used three of these SSPs in this new report too. Here's their commentary on the possible scenarios. Firstly, a sustainability focused chart, which tells us sustainability in land management, agricultural intensification, production and consumption patterns result in reduced need for agricultural land despite increases in per capita food consumption. This land can instead be used for reforestation, afforestation and bioenergy. Then they show us this middle of the road chart with the commentary societal as well as technological development follows historical patterns. Increased demand for land mitigation options such as bioenergy, reduced deforestation or afforestation decreases availability of agricultural land for food, feed and fibre. And then finally there's the resource intensive chart, which tells us resource intensive production and consumption patterns results in high baseline emissions. Mitigation focuses on technological solutions including substantial bioenergy and BECCS, which is bioenergy with carbon capture and storage. Intensification and competing land use contribute to declines in agricultural land. Now, you can't fail to notice that in all three of these scenarios, BECCS, or bioenergy with carbon capture and storage, is a major feature. There's a huge reliance on BECCS in all of the IPCC climate prediction scenarios. It's basically the main mechanism they use to make sure their models can reach the target of keeping average global surface temperatures to well below 2 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial levels. But the strategy is pretty controversial, and many environmental groups are dead against it. Here's a little bit of what the Friends of the Earth have said about the latest IPCC report. Energy companies are currently pursuing several bioenergy sources with a worse carbon footprint than fossil fuels. These also represent a false solution and accelerate instead of mitigate climate change. Burning whole trees for electricity and coal installations is damaging to forests, extremely inefficient, and makes no environmental sense. And burning crop-based biofuels for energy contributes to significant greenhouse gas emissions due to the destruction of natural carbon sinks as a result of agricultural expansion. It also fuels conflicts over land use. Carbon capture and storage isn't a viable alternative either, say Friends of the Earth. CCS is a 20th century concept designed for cheap and plentiful fossil fuels, they tell us. And because extra energy is needed to capture, transport and store CO2, CCS increases reliance on fossil fuels. They go on to say it's a hot topic for big energy companies because it represents for them the hope that they can keep alive the current energy model. Bioenergy with carbon capture and storage, or BECCS, combines large-scale bioenergy and CCS, so even if it worked at scale, which is unproven, to actually bring about substantial negative emissions, it'd require a large proportion of all the world's cropland. And then there's the climate campaigner and Guardian columnist, George Monbiot. He thinks this IPCC report has been a huge wasted opportunity, calling it pathetic in the article he wrote on the same day as its publication. Among his observations and criticisms, Monbiot makes this point. Research published in April by the Harvard academics Helen Harwood and Matthew Hayek, also missed by the IPCC, shows that alongside millions of hectares of pasture land, an astonishing 55% of UK cropping land, that's land that's ploughed and seeded, is used to grow feed for livestock rather than food for humans. If our grazing land was allowed to revert to natural ecosystems and the land currently used to grow feed for livestock was used for grains, beans, fruit, nuts and vegetables for humans, this switch would allow the UK to absorb an astonishing quantity of carbon. It'd be equivalent altogether, the paper estimates, to absorbing 9 years of our total current emissions. And farming in this country could then feed everyone without the need for imports. This is, of course, a view that promotes the move away from human consumption of animal protein and rapidly towards a plant-based diet. And as someone that's felt the benefit of a plant-based diet for nearly 2 years now, I have to admit it's a point of view that I've got some sympathy with. In fairness to the IPCC, the report does endorse the practice of sustainable land management, promoting the stewardship and use of land resources, including soils, water, animals and plants, to meet changing human needs while simultaneously ensuring the long-term productive potential of these resources and the maintenance of their environmental functions. The report references things like agroforestry, conservation agriculture and forestry practices, as well as crop and forest species diversity, crop and forest rotations, organic farming, integrated pest management, the conservation of pollinators, rainwater harvesting, range and pasture management, and precision agriculture systems. These are all extremely important initiatives that our wider society has generally ignored in favour of a perfectly understandable focus on the rapid transition away from fossil fuels and towards more sustainable forms of energy to power our modern lifestyles. Alongside conservation agriculture, there's also a practice known as regenerative agriculture, which focuses on topsoil regeneration, increasing biodiversity, improving the water cycle, enhancing ecosystem services, supporting biosequestration, increasing resilience to climate change, and strengthening the health and vitality of farm soil. And this strategy places greater emphasis on the role that ruminant animals, like cattle, can play in the overall cycle, something that people like George Monbiot thoroughly disagree with. His view on the human integration of livestock into our natural ecosystems is very clear. Here's his commentary. Some people try to argue that extensive farming systems, particularly grazing livestock, mimic nature. While some livestock farms are much better than others, there are none in this country that look like natural ecosystems. Nature has no fences. It has large predators, wolves, lynx and other species that have been eliminated here on behalf of livestock farming, and a wide range of wild herbivores. There's quite clearly a range of opinions here from different groups of people, all of whom completely understand and agree with the consensus scientific view that anthropogenic greenhouse gas emissions are driving up the temperature of our planet's atmosphere, but who don't necessarily agree on the best strategy we need to employ to navigate our way through the choppy waters that lie ahead. So, to try and understand how the science stacks up in each case, and why some of these climate campaigners are seemingly at odds with each other, and often at odds with the IPCC as well, we're going to be taking a much closer look at all of the competing land management concepts and strategies in future programmes over the coming weeks. That's it for this week though. Please do give us a like and a share if you found the programme useful and informative. And if you haven't already done so, please also subscribe to the channel and remember to hit the little bell icon so you get notified of when the new programmes come out each week. It's obviously completely free to do that. All you need to do is click on that icon there. As always, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.